Here's a question for you. What makes a festive balloon like this go up?
Helium.
That's the right answer. 2 points. And what does it do to your voice?
Makes it go higher pitched if you inhale it.
Oh. It doesn't make your voice go up. No, it doesn't go up in pitch at all. It's the timbre that changes.
The timbre?
The timbre.
That's a stamp,
isn't it?
It's... We wanted to give you all some helium to show it by having you sing. But I've got the three worst words in the English language to
health.
Offer you. And f***ing safety. It's four words. It's four words that I'm afraid health and f***ing safety wouldn't let us do it on television.
What did they think could possibly happen?
Throw it away?
No, it's exactly. It's not a poisonous gas, for heaven's sake. You dive, don't you?
Yes. You breathe compressed air for scuba diving.
Yeah, but it's oxygen and helium. For deep sea diving, that is.
So why didn't Jacques Cousteau, when he was always on the World of Bats, go, we have been underneath the sea?
It's his real voice. It's like Paul Robeson.
We have been beneath your sea. There is a gas you can breathe called xenon, which is, I think, one of the inert gases, where you do actually go John Wayne-like when you...
Freon is like that also.
Freon does that, does it?
Yeah. Refrigerator. Yeah, you can suck the back out of a refrigerator and your voice will be much lower. We did it all the time as kids.
Did you now?
Is this what, maybe if you're on EastEnders, every character has to have this before they start doing a bit?
Oh, what, that?
And then they've got... We've got a chalk.
And that's what all the optics are behind the bar.
Piggy! Yes, the fact is sound travels faster in helium, which increases the frequency but not the pitch. And it brings me on to a question for you. What is the difference between a cake and a biscuit?
Oh, that's easy.
Tell.
Well, a cake is soft and a biscuit's hard. Cakes are soft and squidgy and spongy. And biscuits, you can snap them.
What's a Jaffa cake, then?
Very interesting, you should say that.
Well, quite interesting.
No, right. Well, quite interesting, exactly. Exactly. Let's stick to our brief. It's,
Jaffa cake is the exception that proves the rule.
But no, it isn't an exception.
See, what happens on this show, Dara, is he thinks I'm an idiot.
But you think my name is an anagram of diarrhoea. So...
Yes, exactly.
I'm really on their side at the moment.
Well, actually, I mean, you used the right words. Technically, the difference is that when they go stale, a cake goes hard
and a biscuit goes soft.
In 1991, the British government, Customs and Excise, decided they wanted to reclassify the Jaffa cake as a biscuit. The weird thing is, there is zero VAT on cake and biscuit, but there is VAT on chocolate biscuits as a luxury item. So McVitie's went out of their way to try and prove that Jaffa cakes are not chocolate biscuits, they are cakes. And they did so by demonstrating in front of the VAT review board that they went hard when they were stale. And they also cooked a great big 12-inch one to show that it really was a cake that they'd baked.
I always think King Alfred, you know, he was a great man.
Is that
a
cock ring?
That's a really early cock ring.
Made of stone.
Born and big knobs there. King Alfred, who I believe was invented. I'm determined to carry on.
Yes, no, please do.
He invented the navy. He did all. He made all sorts of differences. He was an important political figure. But all we remember him for is some business involving cakes.
Yeah.
You, for example, may yet, Stephen, be remembered for something pathetically insignificant.
Absolutely. I once dropped a pack of Abbey Crunch.
So posh.
They're not
really
posh.
They are posh biscuits.
Posh biscuits are ones that are cooked for you by your pastry chef.
A big...
Actually, there's a true story about the Duke of... I think it was the Duke of Devonshire, but it may not have been. In the Second World War, they would have people from the Ministry of Labour going around checking on everybody, and particularly on the big estates, to see if all these people, someone could be released for essential war work. And they went to Chatsworth, where the Duke of Devonshire's estate was. And they, you know, stopwatch and clipboard, and they checked everybody. And eventually they had an interview with the Duke. And they said, well, Your Grace, we can understand that you need 47 gardeners and 13 undergardeners, and you need grooms, and you need... need chauffeurs and you need upstairs maids and downstairs maids and in-between maids and laundry room maids and still room maids and kitchen maids and nursemaids and housemaids and parlour maids. And we can understand that you need the boy to scrape the knives and boots and you need the butler and the four footman and the under-butler. But we wonder if a man economy might be made. Does Your Grace necessarily need two pastry cooks? To which he apparently replied, "Oh, damn it, can't a man have a biscuit?" Which is, I mean, you know, we're all prepared to make sacrifices to beat the Hun, but I mean, really.
Thanks
for
watching.
For another round of general ignorance.
I don't want to do general ignorance.
Why not?
Because I always get them wrong, and I will not be humiliated at Christmas.
Well, you don't know anything, that's the problem.
Well, you have all the answers, so why... There's no point telling me I don't know anything.
Well, do you think it's easy for me, do you?
Yes, I think it's quite easy for you.
All right, why don't you sit here, and I'll sit there.
Go on. I was only having a joke.
Yeah, well, it's Christmas. It's tradition at Christmas time for servants to be served by the master. Everything swaps round. Go on, show on. Oh, see, oh, it's easy now. You see, this is just lounge back and talk to Phil.
OK, Stephen.
Oh, yes. Oh, hello.
I've been waiting for this opportunity.
Oh, Christ.
A question just for Stephen.
Yes.
Who plays in goal for Aston Villa?
Well, I do know you've got a Swede called Thomas Sorensen who plays in goal, but has he been taken over by Stefan...
Posma, yes.
Posma, yeah. Which is... Which is your number one?
Thomas Sorensen's the number one.
Sorensen.
It's actually Danish, but I'll give you that.
Yes, you played against England.
Yes. This isn't going to work. OK.
I just haven't heard that.
Another question... For Stephen,
oh, no.
You probably all know this one. But, what was Mozart's middle name?
This is going to be a trick question, isn't it?
I don't know. You're the smarty pants.
Oh, bollocks.
Have to hurry you.
Well, you want me to say Amadeus, so I'll say Amadeus.
Wolfgang. His full name was Johann Chrysostomus Wolfgangus Theophilus Mozart. He usually called himself Wolfgang Amard, not Amadeus, or Wolfgang Gottlieb. This question for Stephen Fry. How many states of matter are there?
Oh, hello. Well, if you count plasma, I suppose four. Liquid, solid,
Four is wrong. Six. I'm surprised at you, Stephen.
Oh. Print it down, isn't it?
They are, of course, solid, liquid, gas, plasma, Bose-Einstein condensate and fermionic condensate, sometimes known as filament.
Just done.
This question is for Stephen Fry.
Alan Davis hunched in front of his pub trivia machine. That's a good one. I'll have that.
Which way does the bathwater go down the plug hole in the northern hemisphere?
What's quite interesting about digestive biscuits?
Well, it's a hard-working biscuit, the digestive. You know, you put cheese on it, there goes chocolate on it. It's a base for cheesecake. Really is a sort of Renaissance biscuit. It's a great dunker. It's a very, very hard-working biscuit. But have you ever noticed that there is a slightly fishy taste about a digestive?
What have you been dunking them in?
Or who have you been dunking them in?
Lord. We're in the world of misnomers, but things that are wrongly called.
Do they give you wind?
They were called digestive because they were supposed to be an anti-flatulent biscuit when they were designed in the 19th century. No, that's right. In America, it's...
You better have one of these.
Maybe you've stuffed it up, I don't know. But
I'd like to see an advert for this flatulent biscuit. Hey, try it, don't test it.
We're heading right back down the diarrhea highway.
Welcome to the United Kingdom, Mr. The fact is, they are not aids to digestion. In America, it is illegal to call them digestives.
Of course, in America, do you know what we're talking about? Cookies.
Yeah. Yes.
Right, from the, which is from the Dutch. Koekje, meaning a cake. Right. This is why you call them cookies. What you call a biscuit is more like what we would call, I don't know, a kind of scone thing. You have biscuits and gravy. Explain to the ladies and gentlemen what that is.
Oh, traveller from an arcane land.
What do your people...
Everything.
Well, biscuits
are made from self-rising flour, and then they just slop gravy over, and it just takes up room on the plate.
Right. And it's a breakfasty thing or a lunchy thing? Or?
It depends on what trailer park you live in. Sometimes it's 3 meals a day.
Fair enough. But 450 digestive biscuits are baked every second in the United States.
Really?
Yeah.
They are truly the mule of biscuits.
Look at this picture. What does a rainbow look like from the other side?
You can't see it.
Slightly different.
Yeah.
Just slightly different. It's nice. but it's not as...
the same.
It's a bit... Yeah.
So I look at it, you
You'd
go,
rather be on the proper side, yeah. But it's all right.
It's
I wouldn't bother going round to look at it.
No.
Just go, no, it's better this side.
It's a long journey.
You can't really concentrate on it because there are people going, come around, look at it from this side.
But your first answer was correct, for which you will get
you
some
points. You can only see it from...
from the side that you're on.
From... in, yeah. Otherwise, you wouldn't know it's there.
No, there is a very particular way you can
see it. It's to do with where the rain is and where you are.
Or where the sun is.
Where the sun is and the rain and where you are.
There has to be sun. And the sun has to be behind you.
Yeah.
Because they're light coming from behind your head, and they're going through a raindrop, they're bouncing off the back of a raindrop, and coming back to your eye. And it can only happen at an angle of 42 degrees, which is why it's in a bow. Oh,
yeah. Can you tell me at what point in time human beings were actually able to sing a rainbow?
Ah. Is there a song about singing a rainbow?
I can sing a rainbow, sing a rainbow.
Yeah. There's loads of different ones, wasn't there? Grey and grey and grey and grey. Grey and grey and grey. I can sing a woodlouse. You know.
See? Very good. In Estonia, they believe that if you point at a rainbow, your finger will fall off.
Oh, for God's
sake. I know.
Estonians aren't stupid people, are they?
They aren't.
They're very stumpy, though.
No. Yeah.
Yeah. Indigo, incidentally, what do you know about indigo?
Blue, isn't it?
Purple. It's purple.
Blue, it's a funny colour. Do you remember...
It's the colour of...
silence.
No.
No, I can't.
It's the colour of audacity. See, I'm doing it now. I'm talking like that. It's the colour of audacity.
Stop it. It's a sort of darky blue, isn't it?
No, isn't it a fertility thing?
Well, it's an Indian plant that was used for dyeing.
In what sense would it be a fertility thing?
It's a colour, doesn't it come up on women's legs in circles when they're ready?
Are we thinking of impetigo?
Garters, what you're
saying. Red impetigo? Well, indigo is indigo. It's a dark blue dye used for such things as jeans and police uniforms.
Why do bees buzz?
Joe.
Because they can.
And they buzz so that when they're trapped in the living room, you know to open the window.
It's a thought.
Is it to sound industrious?
Yeah.
You have to look at bees as aerospace workers. Right. And stay with me.
Yeah.
When you're flying, you want to make a lot of noise because a quiet aircraft is. Crashing.
I think it's the knees knocking that makes the buzzing, isn't it? Because they hate flying. Terrified of flying.
What is it that makes the noise?
The wings.
No. No, it isn't, I'm afraid.
Not the wings, then?
No, it won't be the wings.
Testicles.
They're little tiny mouths.
Well, it is sort of little mouths. It's through what they breathe. They're called spiracles. They have them down, down their sides through which they breathe. All buzzing insects, blue bottles the same, it's not the wings. Less than 1% of the buzz comes from their wings. Bees breathe through 14 holes along the sides of their bodies, and they're called spiracles. And each one has a valve to limit the flow of air, which the bee can do, and they can tune it rather like a trumpeter, sort of using his lips. What's that called? Embouchure, or whatever it is. Embouchure. Yes.
Embouchure.
And in the same way that one human lung on a trumpet can fill a vast hall with a great sound, more than it can with its own vocal cords. So a bee can make this extraordinary noise just through controlling its breathing.
Isn't science marvellous?
It is.
Are humans the only species that make unnecessary noise?
Oh, well, that's an interesting idea.
Now, dogs.
I mean, do you think any animals just sit around and hum or just
whistle?
Or talk inanely, Alan? That happens at all?
That's why there are no panel shows in the animal kingdom.
Comes from Glasgow and glows in the dark.
Is it Sir Alex Ferguson's nose?
Is it the River Clyde?
It's not the River Clyde, neither. We're talking about food.
Luminous food?
Yes, luminous food. It's an idea that comes from creatures like the anglerfish.
Is it a deep-fried Mars bar with a torch attached to it?
A deep-fried torch?
Well, you're in the right you're in the right area with deep-fried. What I believe you call carry-outs are the food to go. Yeah. What is the most popular food in Britain, supposedly, these days?
Chicken tikka masala.
Chicken tikka masala, which was invented in Glasgow. And there is one.
Oh, that's a particularly fine example.
That may be a used one. One that's been through the system. I have a horrible feeling.
Morag, get me a bed of rice. The children shall eat.
Well, there is a company called BioLoom, which is planning to have food, including curry, that glows in the dark, using extracts of marine creatures that glow. And they want to make beer, in particular, that glows in the dark, children's fizzy drinks that glow in the dark. Chicken tikka masala is not something that exists in Bangladesh or in India. The story of it goes that there was a restaurant called the Gaylord in 1966, was the first place to serve a proper chicken tandoori.
In Glasgow,
rather popular.
Or London.
In London, Mortimer Street in London. And the story goes, somebody came into a restaurant in Glasgow where they were serving this new tandoori chicken, and asked for some gravy to go on it. And the chef improvised with tomato soup and cream and spices, and up grew this strange creature that is chicken tikka masala, that has no definition, that can be hot, it can be mild, it can be brown, it can be orange, it can be grey. But according to Robin Cook, is the great British national dish.
I have to say, I had a curry once on the Isle of Man where I was doing a gig. It was served with a cup of tea and some bread and butter. Fantastic, don't you?
Can I just mention that since we're being disparaging about the Scottish diet, that we don't all eat chips every night. Sometimes what we do is we have some chips and leave them aside till the morning. And we have them cold the next day, and that's a salad.
Deep-fried pizza is the and Mars bars.
It's a myth.
It's a myth.
Not a myth. The Mars bar as well. It happened once. He dropped his Mars bar. I'm no wasting that. He scorched his hand getting the wrapper off.
Is it possible to die and come back to life after 3 days?
Cryosthenics.
Sort of. Know what you're saying there, yes, cryogenics, yeah.
I nearly said calisthenics.
Yes, it's a mixture where you do exercises while you're frozen in suspension. Yeah.
Cryogenics.
Well, yeah, they're freezing
people. They freeze you and bring you back to life.
Well, what you want to be is a water bear. which has another rather sweet name, which is a tardigrade. There's one.
Is that it?
Oh, yes. That's not a bear. No, it's the Sydney Opera House.
Really, he is a Sydney Opera
House. It is, isn't it? You can see where he got the idea from. No, they're not very big. I mean, you can see them with the naked eye. That's magnified. We've done all kinds of nasty things to them. We have boiled them, frozen them, poisoned them, suffocated them, dehydrated them, and bombarded them with radioactivity. And still they live. They just put themselves into suspended animation in such a state without any metabolism going on until things turn out nicely for them.
That's not and a very nice way to treat a bear.
It certainly isn't.
I've been bombarded with radiation, boo-boo, and they're frozen me empirically. I'm gonna be dead for a thousand.
Oh, yogi.
Well, in fact, tardigrades have been frozen to within 1 degree of absolute zero.
I thought you were going to say to within an inch of their life.
I should freeze you within an inch of your life.
Do you have that as a superpower, if you could? What would your superpower be of choice?
Invisibility.
Really?
Yeah, I think...
Would you?
Oh, that'd be great fun. What would you like?
I'd like to have no bodily smell.
I would like to travel ahead in time, but only by 2 seconds. I could go gazoon type, and you would sneeze.
You would really freak people out, wouldn't you? That's a very funny idea. What is the collective noun for a group of baboons? Yay.
The Pentagon.
Fantastic. Oddly enough, American politics has a lot to do with it, and not only is the Pentagon an organ of American power, but so is their house.
Capitol Hill, the White House.
The House is known
as... House of Representatives.
House of Baboons?
It's the Congress.
The Congress.
It's a Congress.
It's a Congress of Baboons.
Yeah, but the reason we ask the question is...
Congress of Baboons.
Very good. But there is a quite interesting fact about a new word that is beginning to replace Congress, and it has a very odd history, this word. It comes from a comedy sketch on BBC television, in a series called Not the 9 o'clock News. There was a sketch called Gerald the Gorilla, in which Rowan Atkinson played it.
And Wild.
He makes mention, furious. That's right, Wild, I was furious, exactly, the production on that album. But, there's a point where he talks about a group, or flange, as we call them, of gorillas. And this was just made up by Richard Curtis, or whoever wrote the sketch, that particular sketch. But it's now on the net, and there is, I can quote you here, from a book called Sex and Friendship in Baboons by Barbara B. Smuts. This is a review.
He's read every book in the world. Yeah.
This is a review on Amazon.com, and it's a serious academic study, and it says, in this marvellous book, Smuts draws from years of painstaking field research in which he followed around a flange of Chacma baboons in the Mutatu Game Reserve in Zimbabwe. And that, there, a word has migrated from a comedy sketch into the internet and is now being used by academics as the official word. And while on the subject of animals, who can tell me which mammals have the most bones in their noses? Yep. Alan.
Crocodiles.
It isn't crocodiles, as it happens.
I was going to say elephants, but I think it's really stupid.
Thank you. Oh, bless you for
that.
I did it to please the researcher.
Did you say anteaters?
Yes.
Well, the answer is an anteater, so you shouldn't have some points. Particular kind, probably the most famous kind of anteater in some ways.
Aardvark
is the right answer. It has 9 or 10.
Do you know, I can say in Danish, I have spilt coffee on the anteater.
I would like you to do that for us now.
Jeg har spilt kaffe på muslyer.
So, in fact, we have a question for you now, young Rich. Explain how to French kiss a woodpecker.
You would have to seduce it. To get it interested in you.
Right.
Put a toothpick in your mouth. Say nice things to it. Oh, that's nice plumage.
Does French kissing mean kissing with tongues?
Yes. Sorry.
Are you seeing anyone at the moment?
Sorry. Yes, with tongues.
I thought that's very attractive. why would anyone want...
They are very extraordinary things, woodpecker tongues. Let's have a look at a woodpecker tongue. You'll be astonished. There you go.
Oh!
It's one of the strangest things in nature. It's an amazing organ. It can extend to two-thirds of its body length. It's covered in sticky saliva, vicious barbs, and has an ear at the end of it. Which you can listen to its prey. So it uses the beak for pecking at bark
an
and making
ear
a hole.
At the end of its tongue?
Well, a thing that detects sound.
No. Sorry, can you say that again?
Absolutely. How does it fit into its mouth, you may wonder? Well, it has to wrap it round its brain and the back of its eye sockets. Funnily enough, woodpeckers are very popular on creationist websites because they argue this is such an extraordinary creature designed, you know, so fit for its purpose and so on, that only a designer could have made it. It couldn't have evolved. Apart from anything else, when it moves, sometimes up to 15 or 16 times a second, it beats the wood to make a hole, which is incredibly fast, and generates immense forces, 250 times more forces than an astronaut is subjected to. It's 1,000 Gs. And it has these extraordinary kind of little muscles and in cartilages around its brain to sort of stop it from shattering.
I think this drawing looks like, you know, when you go to IKEA and they give you instructions for putting something there. That's what that looks like.
Insert tongue A into groove B. If the pecker's got wood, why go for tongue, you may argue. But it is a pretty astonishing animal.
Maybe we have an offshoot of this programme called Quite Unnecessary. Can I be on that?
When are penguins found near the magnetic North Pole?
Well,
yeah.
When they're wearing a suit of armour.
They're going to be soon because the magnetic north and south is going to switch any minute now.
Oh, give them five points. Absolutely spot on. Yeah. The trap was to say, well, of course, penguins only live near the South Pole, so they'll never be near the North Pole. But the fact is, the north and the south flip in magnetic.
I think penguins might be my favourite animal.
They are wonderful, aren't they?
I like the one on the bottom left.
It looks like security.
It does. Yes, the actual root of the question, though penguins are, in so many ways, I suppose, more interesting, was that the North Pole becomes the South Pole and vice versa every million or so years.
So any minute now, everyone's fridge magnets are just going to fall on the floor. Loads of people start believing in bloody God again.
That's not how fridge magnets work. What will happen is compasses will point to the south rather than the north.
That would be great for orienteering, wouldn't it?
I think people get used to it quite quickly, though.
No, they won't.
I think they will.
North, not south. I don't live in South London. I don't care what you say.
I'm with you there. Oh, dear.
Do we know why it happens? What's going on?
No, we do. It's a very mysterious process.
Just somebody flicks a switch.
If the Earth were not magnetic, there would be no life on it, at least certainly no life like us, because... Yeah, the magnetism deflects the solar rays and the...
I want you to imagine that the penguin is a malicious and dangerous conqueror of peoples. And now look at that picture.
I think they don't have many predators, obviously, in the Antarctic, they don't.
Polar bears eat them.
They don't live in the same continent.
Do they?
No.
They never
met. Polar bears in the north.
Polar bear lives in the north and the penguins in the south.
Yes.
They've never seen one another.
No. Except in
zoos. In my mind, they all... It's like lions and tigers. In my head, they're all hanging out together.
But lions and tigers don't either. Yes, exactly. Lions, Africa, tigers, Asia.
Imagine if it was like that with men and women. Here's a thought, right? Do you think it would be better if it was harder to conceive but easier to give birth?
If I was a woman, I would certainly think that, I should imagine.
I mean, who cooked that up?
It's pretty mean, isn't it?
It's all backwards, isn't it?
Yeah. You're right.
Oh, yeah, you wouldn't want gasping agony for 36 hours to conceive.
That's usually what it sounds like. What bulges up and down by about 30 centimetres twice a day?
Is it a fat pilot's ankles?
Mount Everest.
Yeah? Not well, actually, sort of expand that, the whole surface of the Earth.
The Earth's crust?
Yes, the whole Earth.
Is it?
Yeah. In the same way, we know that the seas do, because of the tidal pull of the moon, but actually the Earth, too, is also pulled slightly. The actual physical.
Can we clear up once and for all how the moon makes the sea go in and out?
That's. If you think.
I don't know that. What? He's just chicks. Like
object in space are attracted to each other.
A ratio which is the inverse of the square of their distances, as Newton made clear. It was...
the moon... See, that's too hard, you see? So, or... Imagine you're talking to a small child. Yes.
I was!
You were enough.
Imagine that the sea is made of iron filings and the moon is a magnet. Use another form of attraction.
Why is the moon a magnet?
Because it has a gravitational effect, which is a force like magnetism.
Surely the Earth is stronger than the moon. Why doesn't the moon get pulled into us?
Well, it is. It's in an orbit. It's entirely around us.
But it's fighting
against it. But it still has a... You know, we have a massive effect on it. If it had water, obviously its tides would, you know,
be a terrible state.
Yeah, but so as it's over each bit, it's literally pulling the seas, and they bulge, and you get the tides.
Does it pull the liquid in people though?
We are some extent,
90% water, aren't we?
Yeah, there is an argument.
Aren't we going? Yeah. The whole time. Never mind all this. Oh, you've got Pisces rising in your.
No, you're absolutely right.
It's all just a distraction. The moon's making us go roar, all the time.
It's not making us do that all the time, or we would have noticed, but in a very minor way.
Some people do that.
We behave a little bit like the Spanish basketball team.
Have you ever heard of a thing called a book?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
And you open them up at the front, right, and there's all the words. And it
it's always good to learn. Sean, it's never good to mock people who are trying.
Hang on. When you say trying...
No. 1988, ladies and gentlemen, in 1988, Warner Communications, as then was, paid John F. Zengstack $28 million for the rights to a single song. Just want to know what it was. 1988. Yes, Linda Smith.
A bit pricey.
It was. It was. They reckon they'll do very well out of it.
National anthem.
Twas not the national anthem. It was not the copyright. Yes.
Was it the theme to Button Moon?
Lovely idea. It wasn't that.
Okie dokie.
Happy birthday.
Ah, thank you very much, Mark Gatiss. It was indeed happy birthday to you.
Aye.
Which was composed in 1924. By a couple of old biddies.
$28 million.
$28 million. They make about $2 million a year out of it.
What did the people sing in 1923, for goodness sake? They brought the cake out, everyone just stood about in a slightly awkward silence.
Which is infinitely preferable than having that bloody song sung at you.
You're older, you're older. You're older.
Yeah, it was written by these two old things, and Irving Berlin included it with the words Happy Birthday to You, which they didn't write. Nobody knows who did write those. He included it in a 1933 musical, so they sued and won and retained the copyright. And in theory, if you sing it in a restaurant, you owe Warner Brothers money because it's counted as a public place.
You'd have to be very honest to find them out and go, it was a birthday, how much do I owe you? And I hummed a few bars and Let It Be as well.
Happy Birthday was the first song to be sung in outer space from the Apollo 9 crew. Do you know what the original song was written as, what the lyrics were? They weren't Happy Birthday to You, as I said.
It was a Death Row song. You won't be alive tomorrow.
Yeah. No.
Don't bother making your bed.
No. Really, really good idea for Ainsley Harriet would be Ainsley's Death Row Dinners.
What's the odds?
Because he's so jolly.
Now, originally it was written as a teacher's song to sing to their class, Good Morning to All, it was called. Then it became Good Morning to You, and then Happy Birthday to You. That's
what
it,
kind
sir.
Of music do spiders like? Well, I reckon
they
got eight legs, they'd appreciate a one-man band. Chicka-chicka-ching, doom-doom. No, they'd kind of appreciate that all-round entertainer.
Etc.
Kylie Minogue.
What is that?
Spinning Around.
Oh, Spinning Around, very good. You could have said Andrew Lloyd Webber, I suppose.
Yeah. Ah, actually, on a similar note, might it be Cliff Richards? Because his real name, Cliff Richard, rather, I beg pardon, Webb.
It's his real name,
Webb. Marty Webb.
Marty Webb. It's all just, isn't it?
But I don't think spiders are that into puns. I think they like flies, stuff like that. Jeez. I'll tell you an interesting fact about spiders. The huntsman spider, which, a little fact everyone knows, doesn't actually build a web, is the only spider with lungs.
Oh, I like that.
So you can get it a birthday cake with a candle on.
Yeah.
That's a sweet thing to think of. What a nice way of thinking.
What do spiders do to flies?
They wrap them up in web, like in Lord of the Rings.
Yeah,
like
and
silk.
And then take them off, wait till they've softened up a bit, and then they eat them.
Well, that's the other thing, they don't eat them, they drink them.
They drink them.
Because they squirt them with acid that dissolves them into a sort of
flies,
liquid.
When they land on your food, kind of they immediately vomit on it. Mm. And then they tread about on it like that, get it all mushy, and then they digest that.
That's quite rude, isn't it?
It is. They listen with their feet. Their 8 feet.
Here you coming.
And they have a penis on their head.
Oh, yeah.
That's on the end of a little feeler. That's where their mating organ is, the males.
They're just a mess.
Exactly. They're all dickheads. they have 8 eyes as well, most of them.
Spiders have eight eyes and 8 legs.
Yes, yeah. Well, the answer to this question is it does seem to be classical music, because they did an experiment and they found that University of Ohio, in this instance, is they, or are they?
The University of all else better to do.
Well, no.
Formerly the Polytechnic of all else to do.
So, domestic spiders were subjected to Bach, techno, I believe is some kind of modern music, and rap. For techno and rap, they built their webs as far away from the speakers as possible. And for classical music, close to it. Someone very close to me told me about a music called Tesco. Do you know about that?
No.
It's a blend of disco and techno. Sweet. And it's Tesco. And they have Tesco evenings in certain nightclubs.
Really?
It's a type of modern young person's dance music, like two-step UK garage, for example. Which is my particular favourite.
These would be nightclubs right on the edge of town.
On the edge of
plenty of parking.
Where is it possible to live on a diet of smut without the neighbours complaining?
In the green room at Channel 5.
A diet of smut is the clue, however.
Oh, I'm sure it's some sort of Norwegian food or something?
Not Norwegian. It's called smut because it's a sooty black thing in its most primitive form.
Caviar.
No, really sooty and smutty in that sense.
A bit of coal.
No, but a living thing.
Fungi.
A fungus, exactly. It's a fungus, like a little...
Why
like a
did
little
the mushroom
blood.
Go to the party?
No, no.
Oh, not that joke. Why did the mushroom go to the party, Alan?
Because he was a fungi.
Lovely. Lovely.
What's wrong with that joke, then?
That's a joke for, like, an imbecile. You know, of kind of 0.7 years old.
What's brown and sticky?
Oh, no. I don't know.
A stick. I'm worried by the audience reaction.
What do you call a boomerang that won't come back?
A stick.
A stick.
Do you have any other jokes where the punchlines are
loads.
Stick? All right.
What's orange and sounds like a parrot? A carrot.
What's red and silly? A blood clot. Look at me like that, you pig-eyed sack of shit. Don't you do that.
You spoiled it.
Now the smuts, smut fungus, Ustilaginales or something similar, is found in Mexico, in particular where it's prized as a food.
What's right. Red and sits in the corner? A naughty strawberry.
Very good.
What's green and sings? Elvis Parsley.
Best floor of a building out of which to throw a cat.
Lovely.
That's impressive.
Lovely mahogany.
A mahogany floor is the best floor. It's the best story of a building with an E.
It's only a guess. Yeah. I'm guessing, but I reckon it must be about the 5th floor, something like that. Because if it's too, assuming you're trying to do the cat some harm, which I object to, but if you want to kill the cat, if that's the idea, if it was only the 1st floor, it would survive because they're very springy animals. And if you go too far up, I'm guessing they form a sort of parachute with and they float down. But like the 5th floor would be about right, and they'd be still hurtling, and the parachute effect wouldn't come in.
Yeah, absolutely right. But the fact is, we don't want to harm them. We want to be nice to them. We want them to survive.
Oh well. Very, very high floor, then?
Well, the 7th. Anything higher than the 7th. They experimented by studying, not by throwing cats out the window. They studied 132 cases of cats falling out of windows in New York. This is the American Veterinary Center. 132 cases of
or
cats
were they
falling or being pushed out of windows and surviving. And the injury rate went up. The average was...
Tick.
The average was from about the 5th floor.
God. And the higher up you went towards the fifth floor, the more injuries there were. But the moment you got to seven and past seven, the fewer injuries there were. Because they can reach a terminal velocity, which is 60 miles an hour, from whatever floor, from an aeroplane, cats have survived. And like a squirrel, they spread themselves out and parachute, as it were, parachute the squirrel. Onto the sixth floor window, they haven't got time to get to that terminal speed and to get the position right. Exactly.
Have they done this? Have they done this with other animals? Have they done hamsters, dogs?
I'm not sure.
Like cows. I'd like to see them do cows.
I fear somehow these cows. There's a man in Shropshire who catapults cows. He puts them on a catapult and flies them through the air, hundreds and hundreds of yards.
Does that not harm
dead cows?
Oh, dead cows.
Yeah.
Oh,
right. But I would urge people at home not to try it with your cat if you're a young person.
No.
Not because it isn't valuable and scientific, but because of the mad letters I get from cat people every time. Why is this picture a double first?
Are they going to use the penguin to blow up the Scotsman?
It's a brilliant one.
First time the pipes are played in the Antarctica.
Yes, it's probably the first time a penguin was ever subjected to any kind of music.
A penguin, 2 seconds later, went like that.
This is the first ever Edinburgh Festival.
Would that it were. Now, did you know...
What did it wear, Stephen?
Robert
what did
Robinson.
It wear?
What did it wear?
No shush and tish and this one for mother and oldest son.
Did you know that 50% of pipers, I don't mean newspipers, I mean bagpipers, 50% of pipers suffer from repetitive strain injury. And and also are hard of hearing.
That is poetic justice.
That's exactly. Very good. Excellent. Oh, how neat. No, it's the first postcard ever to be sent from Antarctica.
Obviously, you don't bring a lot of stuff to Antarctica. This guy had to drag his back. What if they'd hit a crevasse? Too much weight, and it turned out it was just because he brought a...
You never know, it might have saved his life. It might have just caught in the crack and he would swing from it. That did come out oddly, but you know what I mean. Does your bird like chocolate?
My bird?
Yeah, does she like chocolates?
My bird likes chocolate, yes. It's very popular with...
Have you got a bird, then?
I don't know. Say you had a parrot, they'd like chocolate.
Would they?
Because, yeah, their hook beak's great for getting right into the toffee. You know. If you had a pelican, they don't like chocolate, they like toffee better, you know. And if you have an owl, they quite like chocolate behind them, because then they can rotate, you know. They show off, they show off. If you give a crow a Malteser, it's like, no way, you know. So my bird, no, you can't give animals chocolate because it's got something in it that makes them depressed.
You know, that's right.
It you can't them... give chocolate to a dog because it's not right. And the dog, you have, that's why you buy special chocolate for the dogs, which if you want to save money, you can still give the kids, tell them it's dusty and old, you know, like, you know, February chocolate, you know, Christmas chocolate's gone white and dusty.
Oh, I've eaten, you know, dog chocolate.
Pet chocolate, have you
eaten? Yes, I have.
It's like a phrase, isn't they it? I've eaten dog chocolate. Yeah. It's different. It's part of folklore now. So, no, my bird don't like chocolate.
It's a website.
No, my bird doesn't like chocolate, you're quite right.
How many points does he get for that?
Well, he's correct. He'll get some points, perhaps, from our scorers, if they're in the mood. How good is their sense of taste, birds, do you imagine?
Absolutely minimal. They've no need. It's a seed, I don't care, get it in.
Yeah, yeah. They only have about 20 or 30 taste buds on their tongue. They could never distinguish chocolate from anything
else. I thought it was less
else.
Than that, actually.
Did you?
Yeah.
Did you? Yeah.
I thought it was 15 to 18.
And humans have how many, would you say?
25,000.
It's about 9 or 10,000, something like that.
Pretty close.
But they grow, new ones grow every 5 days. They last about 5 days, your taste buds. Of course, wouldn't they be able to tell what chocolate is, but it would be toxic, it would kill them.
Kill them?
Yeah, it's actually poisonous to us, but the lethal dose is quite high.
If you have a whole tin of Quality Street, would that kill you?
About £22 is the lethal dose for a human.
That's nothing.
Nothing.
Quite interesting about the birth of Julius Caesar.
Yes.
It was a wolf. Something with a wolf.
Shut up.
them all. I think it's an unfortunate sort of illusion of Romulus and Remus there, not Julius Caesar.
Right.
Romulus and Remus were said to have been suckled by wolves.
Yes.
Caesarean section.
Oh, dear, oh, dear, oh, dear, oh, dear, oh, dear. Oh, dear, I'm afraid that's another cunningly laid trap you've fallen into, Mr. Bond. It's...
I felt that not happen, to be honest.
I know, yeah, I know. It's sort of inevitability.
There's something
inevitability.
About that that felt
no,
like...
The fact is that...
I'm a bit lemming-like, aren't I?
It's small and furry and attractive.
Stephen Wright said he was born by caesarean section. It doesn't really affect him, except when he goes into a room, he leaves by the window. Julius Caesar was born by caesarean
no,
section.
No, he was
well,
not.
Why, well, what does it mean, then? Why is it caesarean section?
It's a corruption
section?
Of the word cadere, meaning to cut. There was such a thing as of what we call caesarean section in Roman times, but the mother always died. The only way they knew how to do it would always kill the mother.
Slash and grab.
Aurelia, who was Aurelia, who was Julius Caesar's mother, was known to have lived well into his adulthood, so he could not have been born by caesarean
So that's
section.
Not the answer.
How was he born?
How was he born?
Oh,
we don't know anything particularly extraordinary about his features and birth. We just wanted Laughing Boy here to fall into the
trick
trap.
Question.
I'm afraid it worked. I'm sorry.
So
it was
just a purely a trap.
It was purely a trap. I'm sorry about that.
They couldn't do the eyes, no, could they, the sculptors in M Day?
No, they couldn't.
It's just rubbish.
No.
And they said, what do you think? And he went, that's.
They probably
didn't even try, haven't they?
Covered them in,
though.
They used to paint them.
Covered them in, they're
yeah.
all painted.
Yeah.
Quite right.
Yeah.
Painted.
Do I get points
well,
for that?
Why wasn't
yes,
that
yes, painted?
Painted.
Yeah. Same with English churches, which were all clearly painted.
No, and then, of course, the White Cliffs of Dover as well. That was all coloured in one point. A big jungle scene, the amount of giraffes.
Yeah, what a massive great mural all around the South Coast.
All the different peoples of the world holding hands.
All pointing at Westlife, drowning in the sea. Like going, yay! Do they used to do public drownings? Why don't they do it for people on death row, drown them?
You could ask for your last meal to be coconuts and you could form a raft and...
Who discovered penicillin?
Oh!
Oh, dear, oh, dear.
Obviously.
Oh dear.
I mean, he did.
No, he did.
He did.
No,
he did. On mouldy bread, which you rub in your cuts in the outback.
No. Alexander Fleming. Yes.
Was it Bob Fleming from the farm?
It was
it.
Was it Bob Fleming? Nor was it Ian Fleming.
Alexander the Great.
Nor was it any other Alexander. No. I want you to think of young Arab stable boys rubbing things into their inner thighs.
Mouldy no. bread. Lumberjacks, when they cut their fingers, mouldy bread.
Yep. Ernest Duchesne, who was a Frenchman, who liked watching Arab stable boys rubbing things into their
but
inner
how
thighs.
How would we have known
he
that?
Noticed that they what they rubbed to get rid of saddle sores was the mould on the side of the saddle. The nomadic Bedouin of Arabia had been doing this for 1,000 years.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then they were observed by Ernest Duchesne, who wrote a very lengthy paper about it, submitted it to the Institute Pasteur in Paris, who didn't even acknowledge receipt of it. And he died completely uncelebrated. But it was only in 1949, 5 years after Alexander Fleming, that he was posthumously awarded with rediscovering it. So Alexander Fleming can only be said really to
what
have rediscovered
of?
It.
Do you know?
Ironically, he died of TB, which would have saved him had he had penicillin.
Ah.
So it's just one of those sad things. Why was King Charles the 14th of Sweden ashamed of his tattoo?
It's Dudley Moore, isn't it?
Charles the 14th of Sweden.
Well, of course, Bernadotte, one of Napoleon's
right
generals,
answer.
Went to become king of Sweden.
He did.
And the and was did Charles the 14th was that Bernadotte?
It was.
And he had a tattoo, I love Napoleon, on his
no.
arse. No.
No. He wasn't appointed by Napoleon. He was actually appointed by the ailing Charles the 13th. Mm. Napoleon regarded it as a joke, but Bernadotte had been a young revolutionary, a Jacobin. And he had a tattoo that said, Death to Kings, as a young man.
Wow.
Then he was adopted by the old King of Sweden,
yes.
Charles the 13th, became Charles the 14th,
yes.
And was incredibly successful and completely backed away from France, had an alliance with England.
The Great
with
Coalition.
Russia,
yeah.
Invaded Norway, became King of Norway as well.
Mm-hmm.
And the Bernadotte family still rules Sweden.
Yeah.
They are still the kings. This,
very
this
confusing that period because, I mean, Napoleon had Irish generals. He even had a Scottish general.
Yeah.
You know, some, just because you came from somewhere, you didn't have to fight for their army.
No, indeed. Yeah. Here are some pictures for us, boys and girls, ladies and gentlemen. Four famous brain boxes. Which is the odd one out? We have
reading left to right, Arthur Conan Doyle, creator of Sherlock Holmes, of course, Niels Bohr, Nobel Prize-winning physicist, Dmitri Shostakovich, Russian composer, and another Nobel Prize winner, Albert Camus, the novelist. Who's the other one? Yes.
There's only one with glasses on.
Camus is the only one smoking.
No, there's two smoking. Is he the only one that played in goal for Algiers?
Ah, no, you're in the right area. Not the only one, by any means. He was the only one who played for the University of Algiers.
Was Shostakovich playing goal for Algeria as well?
No, he didn't. We forget Algeria. They were all first-team goalkeepers. Three of them were.
Oh. Conan Doyle was the only one who believed in fairies.
He also played in goal for Portsmouth.
Did he?
For did he?
Yes, he did. Yes. He was a proper goalkeeper.
So and he would start.
Niels
like
Bohr
that.
Played in the University of Copenhagen first team.
Presumably when a goal went in.
Albert Camus, as you rightly said, was goalkeeper as well.
He was
for
the
University of Algiers national.
Could that just be acknowledged that
we were giving you 5 points for raising
off. Shostakovich was a centre forward.
No, he wasn't.
Banged in 40 a season with Spartak Moscow.
No, he didn't. He was an official.
He was
a qualified referee. There he is. Imposed onto the body, you've got
tunes going round his head.
Of Pierluigi Collina, I think.
Who knows a Shostakovich tune? Bill, I bet you do.
I could give you one of his goalkeeping moves.
But even though he was a referee.
Yeah, oh, sorry.
Yes. Yeah. That's all right. Just keep up. What rhymes with orange?
Nothing.
Oh, dear. Oh, lordy bless.
Flange.
Flange? Orange. Orange. Can you think of any words that might rhyme with it?
Borange.
Borange would rhyme with it, yeah. I don't think there is such a thing as borange. There's borange.
No, borange. Borange.
Lozenge.
That's what you suck up.
sir, Locke's making it up, sir.
They're terribly close, because there's Blorange.
Blorange?
It's a place. Anyone know where Blorange is?
Well, it sounds like it's in Belgium.
No, closer to home. Blorange.
Where is it?
It overlooks Abergavenny. It has a famous car park.
Well, it has
a horse is buried there, a famous horse called Fox Hunter. There's also Gorringe.
If you say porridge with a cold.
Yeah.
Yes.
Porridge.
Have
some porridge.
Lester Piggott goes, oh, we're for breakfast, Lester.
Porridge.
I'm sure that Richard Whiteley on Countdown said that nothing rhymes with orange.
He may well have done, but we're here to explode the myths
Richard
of the Whiteleys.
Explode Richard Whiteley.
I saw him interviewing two bluebell dancers once.
Really?
I thought he was going to have a coronary. Could I have two from the top?
Very good. Here we are, Gorringe. It's a surname. It's probably the same root as Göring. My prep school tailors were called Gorringe, funnily enough.
Really?
We get our uniforms made, yeah.
Leonard Taylor? Leonard Taylor? For, like, a suit you wear when you're five?
There was...
Were you born in the, like, 1850s?
No. You had?
I shall measure up, young sir. Your shorts and cap.
Particular outfitter. It was the school outfitter.
All right.
Which was a tailoring shop, an outfit, school outfitter,
which,
called Gorringe.
Which side does young sir dress on? There's nothing really to worry about.
You should know that. It's written on the toilet wall.
Oh, heavens, why did I mention that?
That's you right. Want to get measured up for sure.
Lord!
Would sir like to wear a cravat on the cross-country run?
Such beasts.
Yeah.
Well, anyway, Gorringe is a splendid English surname.
I suggest, a cummerbund for geography.
I say. Oh. You rather like this pink polenta.
Utter rotters. Gorringe is the splendid English surname of, amongst others, Henry Honeychurch Gorringe, who brought Cleopatra's Needle to New York Central Park, in case you didn't know. What was unique about Good Friday 1930 that urgently required 10 minutes of light piano music?
Did Jesus come back, change his mind, and they had to fill in?
No, it was a news programme, but instead of news, they played 10 minutes light music. Why would that be?
Because something had happened?
Quite the opposite.
Something nothing had happened.
Nothing had happened.
And there's no news today.
An announcer came on and said, ladies and gentlemen, there's no news tonight, so here is some music. Absolutely true.
Yeah. There was no news.
Nothing.
Well, in fact, we've tried to check what did happen, and aside from football matches, in India there was the start of what was called the Chittagong Rebellion, but which 700 youths attacked the telegraph office and disconnected all communications in the city of Chittagong. But that didn't happen till 10 o'clock, which was too late for the news in London. So there was no news, it seems.
They probably didn't have traffic reports.
They wouldn't have had traffic reports.
Here we go, live to the camera at Hanger Lane.
Yeah.
And there's a bloke on a bike.
Norks, I wouldn't give you much chance of getting home before 6 o'clock, and that's a fact.
Yeah. You'd better call up your maid and butler and tell them to put something in the oven.
But that's it. I mean, local papers have to deal with no news every week. They still write the paper every week. My favourite ever, like, when I used to live in Sheffield, the Sheffield Star, it's my favourite ever headline, Worksop man dies of natural causes.
Fantastic. Oh, that's bliss.
But what about the story of the giant microphones invading the BBC? He's terrified.
They were hushing that one up.
That incredible shrinking announcement.
Which war killed the highest proportion of British soldiers?
The American War of Independence. Good guess.
Yeah. English Civil War.
The English Civil War is the correct answer.
Because everybody killed in the English Civil War was British.
Well, that's absolutely right.
So they must be.
Plus, it was an exceptionally bloody conflict.
Very, very
violent. And the population of the country was quite small.
And all anybody knows about it is the hairstyles. All anybody says, oh, it's Roundheads and Cavaliers. And you think, yeah, that's it, really. One lot looks like the Grumbleweeds, the other lot like Lawrence Llewellyn Bowen, so it all kicks off. That man's got a wooden leg and riding side saddle.
Apparently, 90% of Britons cannot name a single battle of the English Civil War. 80% do not know which English king was executed by Parliament. And 67% of schoolchildren have never heard of Oliver Cromwell.
Good.
As a royalist, do you think his name should be buried?
No, he's a dreadful
man. He was a truly, truly horrible, one of the most horrible people ever to have walked the land. But you wouldn't know that if you didn't know about
it. He did terrible damage being a Puritan. He wrecked all our beautiful churches because he ripped away all the iconography and graven images and replaced them with the giant thermometers that you can still see to this day.
So how many British people died in the Civil War?
85,000 on the battlefield. Another 100,000 dying of their wounds afterwards. People who really suffered were the Irish, of whom it's estimated half the population were decimated by the great Cromwell. And it's an example, a friend told me, who works at the Foreign Office, that dear Robin Cook, when the Labour Party came to power, and they were going to be all ethical, we're going to be all good, they took down some picture in the Foreign Office of a Nepalese prince because they thought it was all imperialist, which deeply offended the Nepalese government. And they put up this big portrait of Cromwell, you know, Republican, you know, sort of lefty figure. And the first meeting they had was with the Irish government. Took one look. And it was like showing Eichmann to the Israeli ambassador. In the 7 years between 1642 and 1649, in the period known as the English Civil War, a staggering 1 in 10 of the adult male population died. How much of the earth is water?
2/3.
Oh, wallaby, 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 wallaby. Is not the right answer. I'm counting the whole planet as it is.
Ah, well, no, nothing, virtually.
Quite right. The answer is less than a 50th of 1%. 7/10 of the earth's surface is covered in water.
About 2/3.
Which is about 2/3, which is exactly right. But the Earth is big. It's very, 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 very big.
It's not that big compared to Jupiter.
No.
I raise you, Jupiter. The Earth can go into the spot on Jupiter. Do you know what I think is a bad idea? Humans spreading onto other planets and into other galaxies. That'd be the bad idea. We should stop ourselves.
Why?
Because we're just bad.
What,
no, we are. As a species, we're bad. Don't start giving me Shakespeare's sonnets.
Well, you're giving
me... We're wicked.
Carl Sagan said a rather wonderful thing when they sent out one of those early Mariner probes or whatever, the one with a gold slab on it with digital information, as in binary information.
Voyager,
that's the one. It had information about where the Earth was in relation to the solar system and so on. And someone suggested having some digitised music on a very early semiconductor sort of microchip. And someone said, well, what's good, have some Bach. And Carl Sagan said, I think that would just be showing off.
That left in when, the late 70s?
Yes.
That's only just got to the edge of our solar system.
But it had to get the special connecting bus service from Crewe. Yeah.
Right there. Absolutely.
Well, the Earth may be too small for Alan, but it's big enough for most of our purposes. It has a total mass of about 6 million billion kilograms. Even on the apparently watery crust, the mass of the land is 40 times greater than that of the ocean. What did Mussolini do?
Made the trains run on time. Oh.
No, he didn't. You could argue he made one particular train run on time. In 1922, there was a general strike in Italy, much to the annoyance of many Italian people, and certainly to the annoyance of the king, Umberto. And the fascists, led by Mussolini, were gathered in Naples, and Mussolini made his ferocious speech saying, we shall march on Rome and we shall sort this out, and we shall seize power if we're not offered it, and we shall end this strike. And it became, and Roma, 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 we shouted, and the famous march on Rome began. Mussolini himself went to Milan, didn't go on the march because he was rather scared. He was quaking in his jackboots. But it turned out to be a great success. And the king offered him power and said you must get on the train from Milan, where he was, to Rome, and I will offer you the prime ministership. So he rang up the station master at Milan and said, this train has to run on time. And it was the one train he definitely made run on time. But all the other improvements in the Italian transport system were actually made before he came to power.
Garibaldi, that's a type of biscuit.
It's a type of biscuit.
Certainly, it's a type of biscuit.
And it cracks. It's the difference. You can't crack a cake.
Good. Well, that's all very exciting.
Name something beginning with C that was invented in Corby.
Chow mein.
No, nice thought, though.
The Rank Organisation.
Steel. Was this something of steel?
Lot of steel,
lot
yes.
Of steel.
There are lots and lots of Scotsmen.
Very true. Do you know why?
Because they all came and moved there to get a job.
Yeah.
There are about 40% of the people are Scottish. There's a Celtic supporters club and a Rangers supporters club.
It's the second largest Rangers supporters club in the world.
And there's also the Rockingham Raceway racetrack. These are the things I know
good.
All about.
You see, could this be anything to do at all with the sainted trouser press? We were hoping someone would say, no, the sainted, as you say, trouser press was invented by a man called Corby and has nothing to do with the great town of Corby. John Corby in Windsor invented it in 1930.
Can I just say, it does work absolutely beautifully if you need to keep food warm in a hotel.
Yes. Black foods, mainly.
Yeah.
No, a panini.
Oh, yeah.
For hours.
Oh, yeah.
The new ones have got a little flip-out ironing board. And a mini iron.
The executive.
The executive, yes. Yep. The Hotchkiss 4000.
Something beginning with C was invented in Corby.
No, we can't find anything. We were hoping you would
CDs,
say Corby Trouser Press.
Crisps.
Crisps? Funny you should say crisps. I mean, they weren't invented there.
They're eaten there, though, aren't they?
Yeah. In 1980, they closed the steelworks and 11,000 Corbyites were thrown out of work. But within little over a year, 15,000 new jobs were created, including at Golden Wonder. Its main claim to fame, of course, is that it's the largest town in Europe not to have a railway station. Gasps.
Did they ever have one?
Well, they did. It was closed in 1963, and they claim it'll open again in about 2010.
Surely that'll mean Corby will lose its only claim to fame.
True.
It doesn't steal anymore, it's just crisps and the no station.
63 when it closed.
63.
You remember getting off a train there in 64.
They reopened, and the first thing is that we apologise for the late arrival.
How many heads did Jesus' granny have?
Maternal or paternal?
Well, if you think about it, he only had a maternal grandmother because his father wasn't Joseph. His So he had his mother's mother, but he didn't have a father's mother. Because God didn't have a mother. Ah, yeah.
So I'm not as stupid.
Oh, no, you're not even. No, you're not. You couldn't be.
How many.
No, no, I mean. No.
I couldn't sink as low as Stephen's expectations.
No, not at all, at all.
His mum's mum had how many heads?
Yeah.
One head.
Well, his mother's mother was St. Anne, and rather oddly, she had seven. On the authority of the church, she had seven, because for hundreds of years during the Middle Ages, her heads were proudly on display simultaneously at Lyon, Apt, Aix-la-Chapelle and Chartres in France, in Bologna, in Sicily and in Durin in Germany. And so she must have had seven, because
don't
the church recognised them all.
One
thing Edison did invent, for 100% genuine Edison invention, that we use every day, probably, most of us.
Is it nasal hair clippers?
No, it's not even an object.
It's not an object.
No.
So it's a way of being. Sarcasm.
Yeah, he invented sarcasm.
Oh, right, yeah. Like,
sure. Oh, yeah. It's actually a word. A word, yeah.
Is it Zugzwang?
No. The Germans have that, but very good.
I don't know if we use that every day.
You wouldn't use Zugzwang unless you were a chess player.
I've used it four times today.
Yeah.
Well, you're fine till Thursday, then, aren't you?
Crikey.
No, not crikey. No. It's
Clocky knocky nihilly pillification.
He didn't invent that word, but well done for knowing it. Which means?
The act of assessing something as worthless.
Very correct, yeah.
Ooh.
Yeah. The word is it's a simple word of greeting.
Hello.
Hello.
That's the word.
Oh, he invented hello. Well,
I heard
he invented
a different story about that.
H-E-L-L-O. The word that existed before as hello, H-U-L-L-O. Which never meant a greeting, it just meant an expression of surprise. Hello, what have we got here? Hello, what's this? We still use it.
Do we?
In that sense. Hello, what's that?
Don't we, Bill?
Yes, yes, when we live our life like 1950s detective film. I often go to my fridge and I'm, hello, whatever. Mother, where's the milk?
You beast, you beast, you utter, utter beast.
When they went around Jeffrey Garner's
maybe just a little camp, I think.
Or is it camp?
Oh, hello.
Hello.
I tell there was a greeting. Said people, hello. Hello. Hello.
Well, no, I think it's a bit of surprise as well.
Oh, hello.
Yeah, there's more surprise.
It's been appropriated by the gays. It's one of those.
Anyway.
Oh, hello.
I say that. There you are.
But originally,
hello.
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 Originally. Oh, right. Very
there was a story about hello, though. There was a story that there was a competition in the Evening Standard and they said, well, you know, we want to find out what's the thing that you're going to say when you answer the phone. And they had a competition, people voted on it, and hello came out number one. And what came second was ahoy, hoy. Which, if you watch The Simpsons, is how Mr. Burns answers the phone.
Yes, absolutely. Actually, what it is that was Alexander Graham Bell's favoured method of answering the phone, was to go ahoy, hoy.
Which I still use.
Do you? Good for you. Whereas I get mocked for using hello.
On the phone? No, that's perfectly acceptable.
No.
Hello,
what's going on?
Lord. Stephen, what was the last thing that made you go, hello?
It was a genital wart.
Was it a genital wart? I knew it would be something to do with genitals. I knew it.
Yeah. No, hello happened to be one of Edison's favourite words. When he first recorded sound, he shouted halloo, which is actually a cry from from the hunting field, a view halloo. So halloo was the first recorded word. And he reckoned, Edison, that it sounded very clear. He discovered this while testing Alexander Graham Bell's prototype. So the first written use of hello, spelt with an E, is in a letter from Edison in 1887.
What colour?
What colour, fingers on buzzers, what colour is the planet Mars? Yes, Joe.
It's red.
Oh, no.
I knew that was going to happen.
Well, it may be called the red planet, but it isn't red. I'm afraid it's actually
rusty
brown.
Rusty brown.
It's browny brown, really. No, it only appears red sometimes because of the dust in the atmosphere. In fact, its landscape is a very boring brown colour.
Why are you going there? What's the point?
Oh, human. You are just unbelievable.
You don't. I see. I see. Right. I refuse to rise to the bait.
All right. According to New Scientist, actually, the most recent pictures of Mars issued by NASA were tweaked No. By sort of, you know,
Photoshop.
By using filters and Photoshop, exactly.
Britney Spears on it.
In order to conform. They were tweaked in order to conform with our expectations of its redness. Name all the events at the first recorded Olympic Games in the year 776 BC.
Discus.
How about that go?
Javelin.
No. No. Try harder.
Hammer.
Oh, dear. Oh dear. No, no. I think that way madness lies.
Well, running.
Yes, but running is the answer.
Running, there's running.
Just one race.
Just one race.
And if you get the distance, I will be astonished.
200 metres.
That's damn close. It's unfair. It's very unfair. I think you've taken enough forfeits because there was just one event and it was 192 metres. which is the modern equivalent. It's a stadium, which is the length of the stadium. And that was the only race in the first Olympic Games.
That was the Olympic Games.
The first recorded one.
Yeah.
But they later developed, and indeed included discus and javelin and all wrestling and boxing and all the things you've mentioned. But unfortunately, the first recorded one was just one.
When was the first recorded one?
776 BC. Now, the next question, which is a subsidiary to this first recorded Olympics, is what was the naked chef doing there?
Ding dong.
Yes. Is that a response to the buttocks or...?
Yeah, prime pair.
For war.
Naked cooking for the athletes.
No, not quite.
Preparing meals for the judges. Really? Selling food to the audience. Won the race.
Yes, quite right. The winner was a cook. His name was Coroebus of Elis, and he was a cook, and like all the contestants, was naked.
They all ran in the nude.
All ran in the nude. In the
How
nudie.
Wonderful.
Even the trainers.
I would like to have seen the triple jump.
What about the pole vault?
Oh, dear.
He Coroebus, of course, won by a short head. No. After his final spurt. No, shut up.